so much. I'm quite honored to be here, and I thank you for the opportunity to introduce you to Access. I am the executive director of a homeless shelter for women and children. About 30 years ago, there was a survey done, and it was found that while there were places for single men and single women, if they were homeless, there was no place for mom and their kids. And actually, that's the largest growth statistic in homeless populations right now, are moms and their kids. Last year, we sheltered 524 people. Of that, 254 were children. Of those children, 125 were under the age of 6. 2 of them were newborns. It's amazing the population that is facing homelessness and poverty. We are probably the only company that you'll ever hear whose mission is to be out of business in the next 5 years. Unfortunately, we're not doing a very good job of it. We have 12 bedrooms at Access and we are a 30-day emergency shelter. Right now, I have 50 families waiting for shelter. Nobody's on the streets, nobody's under a bridge, nobody's in a car. If they want, we take care of them and we work with all the other shelters in this area and we find them a safe place to stay. This summer, when it was 100 degrees, our waiting list peaked at 100 families. Pretty incredible. Homelessness isolates mom. She has no help around. Homelessness means that you burned all your bridges. You burned the bridge with your family, with your mom, with your boyfriend. You're alone, you're isolated, you're desperate, you're in crisis. The way you see the world determines how you live your life. And my ladies do not see the world the same way we do. Let me give you a quick example. Gentlemen, I'm sure you have change in your pockets. Ladies, you probably have change in your wallet or your purse. But I bet very few of you know how much exactly you have in your wallet or in your pocket. My ladies know to the penny how much they have, because they have to know. Because tomorrow they're going to have to feed their kids, and if they're on the streets, they have to know if they have enough money for McDonald's, or do they have to eat ramen noodles again, and probably this time on a hook, because the electric bill isn't paid, and she can't heat any water. The way you see the world determines how you live your life. And unfortunately, our ladies live a different way, and see the world differently. The best way to break the cycle of homelessness is to change their behavior. How do you do that? It's through education. It's through case management. It's by opening eyes and planting seeds. And that's what we do at Access. We're so much more than a shelter. We don't just warehouse. We plant seeds. We help people grow. We educate and we advocate. But I'd like to take a moment. Because again, the way you see the world determines how you live your life. How do you see the world? What's your world vision? Right now, there's a little more than 7 million people on the planet. But let's take an admirable number and reduce it to 100 people. 50 would be men, 50 would be women. 2 would be near birth, 1 would be near death. 20 would be Chinese, 5 are North American. 33 must sell their phones, and 25 have internet access. 18 would have cars. 30% would have potable water, the rest would not. But in that village of 100, there's only one, with a college degree. That's the reality of the world view. What's your view? In this room alone, there have to be dozens, if not hundreds, of college degrees. The way you see the world determines the way you live your life. How do we change someone's view of the world? Again, we do it through training and education. And in Access, we have wonderful stories to tell of how some person's life can be changed. Catherine is a sophomore in high school. She came to Access with her mom. Mom had a disability but had lost her housing. She made that difficult phone call to Access and they moved in. Kathy was a little overweight and probably see me, my students, and hated everything. She connected with some volunteers and a child advocate. And because of the help and the counseling and the discussions we had, she all of a sudden got a little more determined to maybe break that cycle, not knowing it was a cycle. As she was heading towards a senior in high school, her mom said, go get your Section 8 voucher and get her apartment. You'll be set for life. Her daughter, Catherine, said, absolutely not. I want to live where I want to live. I don't want to have to choose a Section 8 housing voucher. So she came back to Access. She had been gone almost 2 years. But we have a little to go for anybody who's been there. She came back, got some counseling, got some direction, and a group of volunteers and our child advocate took her on a college tour. She chose the University of Akron. She's right now a junior at the University of Akron, and she's going to law school. We broke the cycle. It happens again and again, and that's the exciting part. Sometimes it's a volunteer, sometimes it's a staff member, but it's someone who makes a difference. Sometimes it's just a hug. Sometimes it's words of encouragement. Carolyn had 3 children. She was a home health care worker, but in this economy, she lost her. She and her 2 teenage boys, 15 and 16, lived in their car, ate and slept in their car for 6 weeks. They snuck, well, I shouldn't say this here, but they snuck into the University of Akron dorm where her daughter was staying because she had already been involved in college. They snuck in the dorm to get showers. At one point, Carolyn decided, they've got to change this. This is just not the way to live. So she made that typical phone call to Access and brought her in. There we sat down, and she was able to just really strategize the future of her life. She started applying for jobs, she started saving some money, and we took the kids and made sure that they had counseling and they had help. They came in angry. Dad abandoned them, and mom's got them stuck and it's done right on the shelter. Ridiculous. They were angry and hard, but as they stayed with us over time, they softened, their attitude softened. They were getting better grades, they were getting involved in school, and we even got them dressed up to go to prom. They were going to be real high school students. Mom found a job, and it was such a good job that she was able to fix her car, move out, and it was fair market housing. She didn't need subsidized housing. Just before they left, I sat down with the 2 teenage boys, 15 and 16. Just wanted to talk to them. What did they like and what did they hate about Access? I knew what they hate, and they... Well, I was correct. They hated sleeping with their sibling and mom in the bedroom. But they knew they had to do it. But the interesting part is I wanted to know what they loved. The 15-year-old said, I'm not hungry anymore. And for the first time in a long time, I've got clean clothes to wear to school. The 16-year-old shocked me because what he said was, this is the first time in a long time I didn't have to watch mom worry and fret about having to pay bills. She's comfortable and we're comfortable. A 16-year-old should not have to face that seriousness of life. He's got a long time to go before he should have to face it. They're still in housing and they're doing really well, and the boys have great grades and are probably going to move on to college for a little bit. Sometimes the unexpected changes lives. A mom and 2 young boys, Toby and Tyler, 3 and 5 year olds, came to our shelter. Mom was very sad and quiet, and the children were very sad and quiet, very introverted, and that's not usual with Access. Most of the kids at Access call us hotel Access. We've got toys, we've got games, we've got food, we've got hugs, we've got childcare. It's a great time. They love it. But these 2 children weren't smiling. They were quiet. They were introverted. They knew something was up. Again, at Access, we empower our ladies. And we want them to change their view of the world. So we got into counseling, our case management worked with them, and we found a horrible story, a horrible truth. Mom and Dad had been married for 10 years. They had a nice small house, they both had jobs, they were well paid, they were middle class, but they were working hard to make ends meet. They had their 2 boys. Dad worked at night, Mom worked during the day, and they babysat together, was at work. So one day while Dad was babysitting, Mom's at work, Dad had diabetes, and he unfortunately slipped into a diabetic coma and died. The 2 boys didn't know what to do, so all they did was lay next to Dad and hug him. Until Mom came and saw the horrible sight of her loving husband and her 2 boys. She tried to make ends meet, but couldn't do it. She ended up calling access, she lost her house, and she moved into the house. We got immediately counseling, and it's helping. We're trying to erase those horrible memories in those boys' minds. It's going to take a long time. But what we can do is give them the opportunity, advocate for them, and get them into places where they can and thrive and survive. There are hundreds of stories like this I can tell you to access. It's interesting because your vision of the homeless may be very different after you hear my speech. But also, you'll never know when you meet someone who's been through the experience. They might be the person who hands you your food to the drive-thru in the morning. They may be the person who serves you food at the local diner. I will tell you my story about Carolyn. She's a home health care worker. She may be working on one of your parents or a family member. They're good people. They make bad decisions, they have some bad luck. You may have an addiction, they may have some problems, but they're just like you and me. Most homeless people are just like us. And most of us are maybe 2 or 3 paychecks away from being homeless. The difference is we have a network of support. These ladies do not. Access becomes that network of support and can change lives. People grow and people are empowered and they make a difference. What do you think of when you hear the word homeless? What do you think of when you hear the word homeless? The first image most people think of is the person at the freeway entrance holding a cardboard sign asking for food or a job. Use your glance at them for a moment and drive on. But please, take a moment and think. Ever wonder what could happen next? What could be on the other side of that sheet of cardboard? What could happen to that person if they received the help or assistance they needed? At Access, we believe and work hard to finish that story. We would like to show you the other side of the cardboard from some of our recent clients.
Little boy is 6 years old. Now too used to be alone. Another new mom and dad, another school, another house that'll never be home. When people ask him how he likes his place, he looks up and stands with a smile on his face. This is my temporary home. It's not where I belong. Windows and rooms that I'm passing through. This is just a stop on the way to where I'm going. I'm not afraid because I know this is my temporary home. Your mom on her own, she needs a little help, got nowhere to call. She's looking for a job, looking for a way out, cause a halfway out will never be home. At night, she whispers to her baby girl, temporary home. The room is filled with kindling lights, and whispers, "Don't cry for me. I'll see you all someday." He looks at me and says, "I can't see God's face. This is my temporary home. It's not where I belong. Windows and dreams that I'm passing through. This was just a stop on the way to where I'm going. I'm glad I found you, 'cause I'm this was my temporary home." This is a temporary
home. Thank you.